Strategic Hotbox with Dr. Brandi Love Stankovic, discussing leadership, business, and how to take control of your life and achieve greatness. From the streets of Las Vegas, energized, informed, and never diluted, it's time to kick some ass.
It's your girl, Dr. Brandi Stankovic, here on the Strategic Hotbox. And today's topic is going to be a fun one. It's a sexy one. It's a really applicable one. And we have our subject matter expert here, Miss Liz Eaton, a longtime friend and entrepreneur extraordinaire and dancer too. So she's, you know, she can kick her heels up on the dance floor and probably kick your butt when it comes to business. So we'll dive right into the topic of strip performer to entrepreneur. So as you know, we take the podcast and we kind of cut it up into three segments to really make it something meaty that you can get your hands around. And that is the learn, the love, and the kick ass. So in the learn section, we're going to talk about what does it mean and why would you need to make a significant transition in your life, in careers? And why would you do that? When does it happen? And then we'll bring in the love section. We'll bring Liz in and we'll talk about what that means and how it applied to her career and the progressions that she's made. And then in kick ass, we'll give you some tools and things that you can start implementing and doing differently today. So when it comes to being a strip performer to entrepreneur, the idea here is a transition from art necessarily to business, from a transition from one area to another. So this could apply to an athlete, for example, that's been working in athletics or living a career of athletics and then gets hurt and then is devastated. It's like, now what? Now what do I do with my life? And I've got to completely change kind of scopes and go somewhere else. Or for those that are in the arts and you're going down a path and you reach a peak or a place where you're no longer going to be as effective, or you don't want to live that lifestyle any longer. So it's anyone that really wants to make a transition from something that they've dedicated their lives for. I was talking to an athlete recently about that very fact, and the fact that they had literally lived 20 plus years of their, you know, adult or teenage to adult life dedicated, hours and hours and hours dedicated to this craft, and now it had been taken away from them. And it's like, what do you even do? You wake up and it's like, how do you even process through that? And so it really is a transition that many of us that are listening and watching can relate to. It also applies to young people. And what I mean by that is you don't have to know what you want to do with your life. You don't have to know and have it all figured out, but don't take time off to try to do that. And what I want to say in that is, so often I will hear young people say, you know, I'm not going to go to school when I graduate because I just want to take some time and I'm not going to work. Or maybe I'll just get this like side job or whatever. And then don't do that. If you're going to do that, at least go to the community college or go do something in the meantime, a technical college, or get some sort of experience in some sort of career. Don't take time off. I was watching The Real World or some show that I probably shouldn't have been watching, but I was totally watching it. And one of the girls on the show was probably like 25. And she's like, I have my own place. I've got my own apartment and I have my own car. And everybody on the show was just like, dude, that girl's got her shit figured out. And she's like, she's down. And then I thought to myself, okay, so she's this hot chick that she's got a car and she's got an apartment. And then she's going to wake up in 5 years and realize that is not enough to be hot. When she's 30, it's not enough to be hot just to have a car and an apartment. But when you're 25 or whatever, it's enough. It's fine, right? And I think that so often the trajectory isn't there. And so people will take time off from their life. And while everyone else was working, while everyone else was going to school, everyone else is doing something to progress in their career, people that aren't are the paths change pretty significantly. And so I urge everyone that's listening is, don't take time off from your life. That go after something and then transition from that something if you need to, if you do figure out that it may not be right for you. And that really is particularly true with a challenge for the youth in Las Vegas. So I grew up here in Las Vegas, and when we graduated from high school, it was really easy to get a job for big money doing something in industry. So whether that was friends that got jobs running valet, or those friends that got jobs running cocktails, or friends that got jobs, you know, doing those different things, and you got big cash, and it's big cash, but it's not long lived. Not many people can have a career in some of these, meaning like a 30, 40 year career in some of these areas. And there's not always progression for growth upwards in it. And so my first life was in dance because I lived Liz and I, and we'll learn a little bit more about Liz here very, very soon, went to a dance school together. And so when I left, I was in dance entirely. And so it's such a enticing market, but it's also something that is very driven where you have to fit within a certain mold. I learned very quickly that I'm not a mold fitter. I'm not a mold fitterer kind of person. And so because of that, kind of broke out of it. But there were some people that fit the mold beautifully and made these gorgeous and amazing careers from it. And so because of that, then had to transition at different times. So all of it does require this transition, however. And so really, it's the hard part in Las Vegas, and the reason that we're bringing it up and we're even bringing it to light in our conversation today, is that sometimes you have to move away from something you love to discover something else that you can love just as much, or a different side of you, or incorporating the artistic and complete sides of you. But it does require a complete change of lifestyle. An example of that, but you know, my final example before I switch it over here and introduce you to Liz, is I have a friend that was a bartender, and he was a bartender in the graveyard shift, made tons of money, but would always get his paycheck and then spend a good portion of it back in the machines, and lived kind of this dark place that does suck in several individuals in Las Vegas. And so because of that, when he did decide to have a change of lifestyle, you also have to change, when you change jobs, you also have to change the lifestyle, if that makes sense. You can't continue to put the money in the machines if you want to completely have the transition. So it does sometimes take a complete mindset, a whole different shift, and celebrate the new. So let's talk a little bit more about that, and somebody that knows more than anyone about how to rock it and make it happen in this area. And that's Liz Eaton. She's lived in Las Vegas since you were 12 years old, so a very long time. And you're a Las Vegas Academy grad, so you're majoring in dance. We had a blast together when we were there. You started your career as a dancer at the age of 18. You've worked on the Norwegian Cruise Lines. You worked on the Strip, which is amazing. You worked for Crazy Girls and Lacage at the Riviera for Harrah's. You danced with Charo for New Year's Eve. Lots of different magicians, even. And then you decided that it's time to become an entrepreneur and to start a different phase of your life. And you graduated from the G Skin and Beauty Institute. And now you practice aesthetics at Stevie's Healing Arts Spa and Yoga. And you're a Dermaplane Pro Certified Trainer, which I love Dermaplane, by the way. It's like the best thing ever. It's amazing. So, hello. Welcome.
Hi,
I'm so
Brandi.
Glad you're
Thank
here.
Thank you for having me.
Yay. So, first of all, tell us about your time as a Las Vegas performer.
Well, it started out as I was just trying to get gigs here or there. I was auditioning for various things. It was go-go dancing. Mm-hmm. When I danced at Harrah's, I was actually at the Harrah's Carnival Court. Mm-hmm. I danced for a 70s disco band in the afternoon.
Nice.
Yeah. And then I would, after that, I danced for an 80s band. And they did like 80s music.
You just have to change costume and switch up your dance moves?
Yeah. And it was weird. It was like at 11 in the morning. Be wearing like glitter.
Only in Vegas, you're 11 in the morning, the eyelashes on.
Yes. And then that kind of went wayside. And so then I ended up, I was serving at Tony Roma's temporarily. And I would go to dance class every day. And I saw this audition for this magician that needed a dancer to go on a cruise ship. So I was like, I'll audition for it.
Yeah, why not?
What the audition he wanted to do is he wanted me to take a dance class with him because he used to be in the Joffrey Ballet before he was a magician.
Oh, wow.
So we went and took a dance class. And when we got done, he said that I had the job. Wow. So one day I was a waitress.
And the next day,
And the next
off.
Day it was 30, you have 30 days to rehearse.
Wow.
Get all your stuff together. And you're going to be gone for 6 months in the Baltic Sea. And I'd never been away from my family before.
Oh, my gosh.
So I immediately got anxiety.
Yeah, right.
And I started rehearsing, and I had a serious boyfriend at the time. I was worried about leaving him. Mm-hmm. But that was the bold move that I made that changed the course of my life.
Oh, that's awesome.
Because going on that ship, I met so many amazing, interesting people, learned about so many different cultures. I was in Russia.
Wow.
You know, all over Scandinavia. I've been to Iceland, Ireland,
Incredible.
Scotland.
It's hard work on a cruise ship, too. You perform all the time in various roles, right?
It depends. If you're in the production cast, you perform about 3 times a week. Since I dance for the magician, we would do all these big illusions. So the cruise was 12 days long.
So did you get your like legs chopped off and stuff?
I got my legs chopped off. I was impaled.
Oh, wow.
I was put in an origami box, a sword box. You name it.
Wow.
You name it, I've done it.
Wow. We need to have an off-camera discussion about how that actually works. So tell us a little bit then. So then you went on to work on the strip, right?
Well, so then I came back from the ship and I was here doing stuff around town, and I ended up having my daughter. And so I was really concerned when I had my daughter. Oh my gosh, my dance career is ruined. I'll never.
Sure. Right.
So when she was 8 months old, I decided I'm going to start just auditioning just to get back into it. Mm-hmm. And I got the first job I auditioned for, which was Crazy Girls at the Riviera. Mm-hmm. And I was not expecting that. And so that led to the next 6 years. The last 3 or 4 years as the dance captain, it was an amazing experience. I had so much fun. I met so many wonderful women.
That's incredible. That's hard work, though. Strip performing is hard work.
It's very hard. Mm-hmm. It's very hard. And you're very under a microscope.
Yes, and your body.
You're too skinny. You're too fat. Mm-hmm. You need bangs. Your forehead's too big. You're too blonde. You're not blonde enough. Mm-hmm. You're always being criticized.
And it was never on your level of dance and that kind of performance. But I certainly remember in any of the auditions and performances that I did, you stand up and they say, okay, not tonight. Or you're good. You're good. You're good. You got to slim. You get whatever. And it just is that kind of strict.
Sometimes you don't even get an audition if you're not tall enough.
Right.
So
yeah.
Sometimes you don't even get to that level. Mm-hmm. With Crazy Girls, it was a lot about fitting the mold, like you were talking
sure.
about. They
mm-hmm.
have, if you look at their advertising, they're all the same body type, all the same height. Mm-hmm. So it was about fitting that mold. And I happened to be the right height and, you know, body type for that show.
And so then it was time to transition, and you want to transition out to become. Was that hard?
It was extremely difficult. And actually, I wasn't even thinking ahead like that. I was mm-hmm. thinking, it's time for me to get out of here. I'm sick mm-hmm. of the politics. I'm tired of being told I'm too skinny or too fat. Mm-hmm. And I did it a long time, and I felt like I got to the place where I couldn't go any further.
Yeah.
So I got a job bartending. Mm-hmm. And so I was bartending, and it was not fulfilling me because I was always doing something that I was very passionate about. And all of a sudden I was clocking in and clocking out.
Sure.
And so then I started reevaluating, what is it that I would like to do that I could feel that sort of passion about?
Right.
And I remembered this. Right when I got out of high school, my mom said, what are you going to do, Liz? And I said, I'm going to be a showgirl, Mom.
Right.
She was not happy about that.
It's like every little girl in Las Vegas, I'm going to be in show business.
Yeah, she just looked at me like, oh my goodness. So she signed me up for school to do nails. Mm. So I went to a 3-month program so I would have this trade so that I could support myself.
Fall back or whatever. Sure.
Uh-huh. Right. And when she signed me up for that, I told her, I said, I would think I would rather do skincare. Mm. And at the time it was 1997.
Right.
And there wasn't day spas.
Did you
anywhere.
Just drop how old we were on this podcast? That just happened in the 1900s.
In the 1900s. Before 20.
So that so, it was back before it was as popular as it is now.
Yeah. So I went and I worked at a day spa for about 8 months. Mm-hmm. And I met a bunch of estheticians there. And so I thought back to that time when I was getting ready to leave dancing. And I was like, I think that's what I would like to do. It's something that I could be passionate about. And I'm really grateful that I found something that
yes.
I'm passionate about.
Because to your point here, you had spent so much and dedicated so much to being there that it's hard to even think outside of that once it's time that you knew it was time to go. But it's yeah. like, how do you think outside of that, you know? Well, that.
And it's scary. And mm-hmm. on another level, you kind of identify yourself. Like for the
sure.
last 6 years before I quit dancing, I was Liz from Crazy Girls. I was Liz from Crazy Girls. So then all of a sudden I was just Liz, and I didn't know who that was. So it took me a minute to figure out my identity not connected to being a showgirl.
Thank you so much for saying that. And I imagine that some girls don't get out, and then other girls end up transitioning to things that they shouldn't. And so often we do attribute ourselves to what we have dedicated our lives to.
Yeah.
And then how do you build the new or build yourself first before, you know, you can do a career?
Well, yeah, it's extremely difficult too, because my husband's an entertainer. He's a juggler and he works on cruise ships. And so here I stopped, I hung up my fishnet, so to speak. And my husband is still, you know, and I missed it. And he's still like, oh, I got to get my costume, or I got to get a new mic, or, oh, I had a standing ovation. And I found myself jealous.
Yeah.
Because I wasn't doing it anymore, and he still is.
Right.
And I had to kind of find a way to find something to make me happy by myself.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
It absolutely does. So what philosophy or what would you share then in this, at the you now that you've gone through it and you've lived through it, what would you share with those maybe behind you or younger women or that type of thing that, that want to make a transition out of that lifestyle? What would you share as a lesson learned?
Well, at first I would recommend if you're a 21-year-old that wants to be a showgirl, while you're being a showgirl, go to school.
Mm-hmm.
Have a backup plan. So that you don't wait until you're 35 and you have two kids right. and you're like, well, what am I going to do? And end up being in the food and beverage industry. Like you were sure. saying earlier, that's what happens a lot is a lot of retired showgirls end up bartending and cocktail waitressing because mm-hmm. we're in an industry town.
Mm-hmm.
So my first advice would be always to think about life after. Do it as long as you want,
mm-hmm.
but make sure you have a backup plan.
Right.
School.
Mm-hmm.
Also, too, I think it's super important to find something because as an artist, it's all about passion.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can't go from doing something passionate to just, like I was saying earlier, clocking in. You got to find something you're passionate about.
Because there would be darkness, I think, in that, too. There's devastation in that because you do lose yourself a bit.
You do. And it kind of, you go through this whole, I don't want to use the word depression, but you go through a whole kind of
downturn.
Trying to figure out where you stand. And I remember when I was bartending, and someone would be rude to me, like a customer.
Uh-huh.
And I remember thinking, you don't even know who I am.
Right.
You know what I mean? But now I'm not that person. I'm a bartender. You know
right,
what I mean?
And right.
It messed with my head a lot.
Yeah. It's hard to, it's like an ego check in a sense.
It's an ego check.
You know?
Yes.
And I think that also in the case of bartending, those that have been really good or had like flourishing careers in bartending or fancier bartending or those kind of things, even that particular thing, Vegas is so about the young and hot, right?
Yeah.
So sometimes bartenders wake up and they're 35 with two kids and there's a 23-year-old with just perkier things.
Yeah.
Perkier things.
That's what happened to in the show, you know? You're 34 years old dancing next to a 22-year-old.
Right.
You know, it's hard to keep up.
It's definitely, yeah. So I think that because of that, you always have to think in the long term. So that's really good advice. So what philosophies do you live by today in what you're doing?
My biggest thing that I do today for my business is every day, well, usually the night before, I think about the three most important things that I need to do the next morning for my business,
mm-hmm.
whether it's a phone call, an email, a post,
mm-hmm.
whatever it is. So when I get up in the morning and I get my kid off to school and I have my coffee, I do those three things first. I don't go on Facebook. I don't check my email. I get those three most important things done first before I do anything else so that my day starts off productive. And every day I do that to mm-hmm. make sure that I'm moving forward every day in my business.
Nice. And I think that's really smart. So getting the important stuff done first, it's really allowing you to prioritize that.
Yeah, because you can waste so much time on Facebook or turning on TV or mm-hmm. sitting there on your email messing around, you know, or on Amazon shopping.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not being productive. And then when you have your own business, the most important thing is you don't have anyone pushing you. It's just
sure.
you. So you have to be self-motivated. And
yes.
so you have to be organized, self-motivated, and every day in some way move your business forward.
Yeah, and that's one of the hardest things for people that transition, even if they aren't transitioning from a performance place, but transitioning to be self-reliant. There's no office, there's no accountability in that. You could be in your PJs and there's nobody telling you.
Yeah.
You've got to be the one to do the work.
Yeah.
So that's awesome. Can you share us a funny story or a mistake that you've made along the way?
Do you want a funny like stage story?
I want all of it.
I have a couple great stage stories.
Great. Tell me.
Okay. So the first one, when I was dancing on the cruise ship with Charles, mm-hmm. The magician, he used to impale me on a sword.
Mm-hmm.
So one time we went to go impale me on the sword and the piece of the equipment malfunctioned.
Uh-huh.
So he had to stop the trick and close the curtain and take me off the prop. Well, so then later on, we're packing up the show. I'm walking through the halls of the ship. I must have had 20 elderly people. Oh my gosh, I thought you were the medic. I thought you really got impaled. They really thought that
because he had stopped the show?
Yeah, they thought that I was stabbed.
Oh my gosh, they're like, oh my gosh, something happened.
And so I just was like, oh, it was a really close call, and I played along.
Right.
And then this is my favorite all-time stage story,
goodness.
Is when I was in Crazy Girls, I used to do this solo, and I was on this tilted bed that turned.
A tilted bed that turns.
So
I'm already intrigued.
Bottom, the bottom part of the bed was where the audience is, and the top... And it turned, and it was kind of like a pinup.
Mm-hmm. Oh, the
kind
outfits,
of like
costumes.
Like a pinup kind of mm-hmm. routine. So it was very sexy.
Mm-hmm.
and there was a motor that would make it spin, and then it would stop at one point in the performance, and then it would spin the opposite direction. Well, I'm standing backstage to go on and do my solo, and the stagehand says, the motor won't work. And I said, well, what are we going to do? He said, well, what I'll do is because it's tilted. So he's like, I'll go behind it.
Oh, no, he's like running
and
around.
And I'll turn it. And you just tell me when to stop. I'm like, okay. And I had no time to think. It was like I had to go
right
on stage.
Show
right
must
then
go on. Sure.
So I go on stage and he's behind me and I'm trying to be all sexy and like pose. Mm-hmm. And he's turning it so fast, I'm going to fall off. So I'm like, hold it, trying to hold on to it. Be sexy. And without the audience knowing, going, stop it, stop it, stop it. And he can't hear me.
Oh, no.
And so I'm like, finally, like, I kind of like flip over and I was like, stop it right now. And so he stops it. And then he's trying to turn it the other way. It was so scary. And I got off stage and I told the producer, next time it's broken, don't ever expect me to do that again.
Don't. Yeah. What if they could just leave it without moving? Did the audience know or did anybody know?
I don't think that they knew.
No. I'm sure they didn't. I'm sure you played it off.
Well,
right. I'm sure anybody that was in the audience probably just was like, wow.
But I always attribute that to life. Like, yes. Life is kind of like that. Like, you get up at the beginning of your day.
Life is like a tilted bed.
It's like a tilted bed when the motor doesn't work, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Some days you get up and the motor works, and sometimes it doesn't, and you just have to keep going.
You just got to be the pinup you were meant to be. I love it. Thank you. So can you share an action item or a bold takeaway for our listeners?
The only thing I would say is if there's something that you want to do, don't hesitate. Just do it. Like when I decided I wanted to go to school, mm-hmm, I went there to look at the school. I signed up and started 2 weeks later. Yeah. Don't wait around. Life is too short. Just do it.
I agree with you.
Yeah.
Absolutely agree. So how can people get a hold of you or get a hold of you and come for some dermaplaning or that kind of thing?
Okay. Well, you can reach me at, Liz Knows Skin is my email, mm-hmm, my Instagram and my Facebook. You can also reach me at Stevie's Healing Arts and Spa. On the website, it has all the biographies of all the people that work there.
Will you spell Liz Knows Skin?
Yeah, LizKnowSskin, one word.
Okay.
And it's Stevie's Healing Arts and Spa. That's where I practice my skincare. We do skincare, waxing, massage. We have Reiki. We have yoga.
Wow.
It's a really beautiful little spa.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Well, I need to come see you too. And we'll post your information on the Strategic Hot Box website as well. So everybody can come check you out. So thank you, Liz, for being here.
Thank you, Brandi.
I'm so glad you're here.
Happy to be here. Thank you.
Let's head out to the shout out.
Live canvas painting party in Helena, Montana. Come on in and paint with us. I just painted tonight with Brandi at Strategic Hot Box. Woo!
Thank you to Lucy Davis from Canvas Painting Party. I had a blast in Montana painting with her, and it was nice of her to do the shout out as well. And she actually promoted the rogue in me when it comes to painting. For anybody that knows my art style, I love to get a little dark or crazy in it. So thank you to her, and shout out to her and everything that she's doing there in Helena, Montana. And thank you again to Liz for being here and sharing her delicious stories with us. Now is my favorite time, your favorite time. It's time to kick some ass. Here's your top five. First, don't take a year off from life. Liz said it best, don't wait around, just get up and do it. She said 2 weeks later she was signed up and doing school and going after it. And that's the key. Don't take a year off from life. It's time for us to get up and make things happen. Number two is commit to the change. Don't look back. So if you find yourself in a place of transition, commit to it. It isn't about a dabble here, a dabble there. Kind of look at your previous life or the previous thing, the thing that you're leaving as an ex-boyfriend. It's never a good idea to dabble with an ex-boyfriend, right? It just doesn't make any sense. So you want to make sure that you're committing to the change, that you're focused on the future, and don't look in the rearview mirror. Number three is to be confident. Know that you can be Liz without crazy girls, right? And know that I can be Brandi no matter what that is. And you can be you, that it's about being confident, whatever decision and transition that you're making, and being the best and most delicious thing that you can be in this new place that you are in your life, whatever that transition looks like. Number four is create a new lifestyle in addition to the new transition that you've had. So the example with the stories that I gave you of people that get sucked into the lifestyle that they were living. And so making sure that, it's an entire life change. It's not just a career change. It's an entire life change to make sure the new friends and environment communities that are supporting you are also supporting this new life, career, lifestyle that you've developed. And number five is incorporate art in your new venture. So the more that you can have a little dance in your new entrepreneurship, or the more that I can have a little performance in what I do. And clearly you can see that although I may not be hip hop dancing, I certainly am doing a certain aspect of stage presence and things in what I do every day. And I know that Liz does a lot of that as well. So the more that we can incorporate our whole selves in what we do, that makes that transition that you'll be going through that much better. There's your top five. Kick ass. So thank you again to Liz. It was so fun to hear stories of you, and I'm glad that you didn't throw me under the bus and say some crazy stories from back in the dance days. I lucked out. But we'd love to hear from those of you that are listening and watching about what you'd like us to tackle on the Strategic Hot Box. Share your thoughts with us on Twitter at Brandi Love, B-R-A-N-D-I-L-U-V, or Instagram at Brandi Love or at Strategic Hot Box, or email us podcast@strategichotbox.com. And any ongoing access that you'd like to have for executive coaching tools or leadership development exercises, or just access links to where Liz is at, links to any of our guests, all of that stuff you can find at the strategichotbox.com, our website. And if you want to get a jump start, know that you can find some worksheets, some fun stuff, some exercises to get you going out there as well. So be the pinup that you were meant to be, because life is like a tilted bed when the motor doesn't work. And get out there until I see you again. Get out there and kick some ass.